Hello, and welcome to the final installment of our three-part video series on investigating masquerading activity in Windows Defender for Endpoint. To recap, before we did any of these videos, we launched an atomic red team test that was designed to emulate masquerading activity. We then investigated the alerts generated by that masquerading activity, showing you what you want to look for and how you can triage those alerts. From there, we went into Defender for Endpoint's response actions, and we showed you how you can actually respond to an incident or a series of alerts using Microsoft's Enterprise Endpoint Security platform. And finally, in this last video, we're going to explore the advanced hunting console to include how you can automatically or build custom Kusto queries. Kusto queries, by the way, are the query language that Defender for Endpoint uses to search through raw telemetry in the advanced hunting console. Last but certainly not least, on the back end of this video, we're going to talk through how you can leverage the advanced hunting API to stream data into another service to achieve defense in depth. So without further ado, let's head back over to our principal solution specialist, Joe Savini.
They have a dynamic Kusto query generator up here called Hunt for Related Events. Now, there's a lot of valuable information that comes out of advanced hunting. Primarily, I mean, this is where Red Canary, where we get all of our information to perform our services, is through a live streaming API specific to this data. Now, when you go ahead and click that button, it's going to generate a pretty advanced piece of Kusto query language output. Now, it doesn't need to be this advanced, though, to get information. And this is something that we sort of wanted to just provide a basic example of how you might use Kusto queries to generate some of your own information and to do some of your own process listings or get some other information. So for example, we want to find out what processes were on our impacted host. So to that end, we have a very, very basic query that we can do actually. And I am having a bit of a window trouble. Here we go. So just a really basic query that we can input. That's just going to list over here is the schema in advanced hunting. And we're just going to list some device process events from our particular device name. So this is just to give you an idea of how flexible and powerful the Kusto query language can be and the data that's provided. So we have quite a bit of fields here. And one interesting thing that we want to note is that you have this capability of viewing a specific number of items per page. This is for performance reasons. When you select larger amounts of items, it's actually going to take a little bit longer to process those. Another thing is that it might not be conducive to examine all of this information in the browser. And to that end, Microsoft has provided an export function. So you can actually download this as a CSV and look through it that way. So this is some great information about this host that we can get in a live sense to find out what happened here. But I think something that would be a little bit more interesting and something that pertains specifically to our incident is a query that looks something more like this, where we're looking on the host. This is a device ID, where the process command line information of that host, which is something that we can get from our process events table over here, contains this particular command line parameter. Now we know from our triage that that command line parameter was used to pass a base64 encoded argument to notepad.exe, which was actually PowerShell. And so when we jump into that, we do see a notepad.exe in this list, and that's not a typical item that should contain that process command line. So we've actually just used advanced hunting in a very, very basic way to discover the same suspicious activity. But then you might think to yourself, like, that's interesting because we're seeing it on a single host. Is there any way that we can apply this to see maybe other base64 encoded commands that happen outside of PowerShell specifically or outside of this host specifically? And so another way of doing that is if we do something like this, we're just barely modifying this command. Now, what we've done here is instead of looking for the E for encoding, we're actually searching for this equals equals string. And this is a common padding that's appended to base64 encoded strings. So rather than just having to look for a command line parameter or switch, we're just going to look for the padding in and of itself. And when we apply that, it actually reduces the amount of noise that our query returns to only these notepad.exe options. But there's actually a better way of now taking this information that we've had through the process of kind of optimizing this to sweep the environment, if you will, to look for more processes across all of our systems that contain that type of padding, that base 64 padding, because that might reveal something suspicious is going on. In the case of this attack, it definitely did. So here's our query now is basically going to be looking for that padding. But what we're doing is we are creating an exception here. We see where file name does not contain sense. And the reason we're excluding sense is because that is the actual Microsoft Defender for Endpoint sensor in and of itself. And those tend to contain a lot of this base 64 encoded strings. But when we look through the environment, we're seeing some CMD activity that contains that from one of these machines. We're seeing more notepad activity. We see notepad activity very similar to what we saw in our original test, but we're seeing it on different systems. Speaking of that, Brian, I think this would actually be a great segue here to show some of that information in the Red Canary portal and how it relates to the information that we've been examining inside of Defender Security Center here.
All right. Thank you so much, Joe. And as you were just saying, right, so Red Canary takes all of that raw telemetry out of Defender for Endpoint via the Advanced Hunting API, and we stream it into the Red Canary engine, where we parse all of that telemetry against our own library of detection analytics. The data that we pull in includes a lot of those data fields that Joe was just searching for with the Kusto queries. So there's a very, very, very wide array of different data sources that we can pull from through Defender for Endpoint to then run that information against our own detection analytics. And that's exactly what we did here, right? So we ran that Atomic Red Team test. The Atomic Red Team test generated some alerting in Defender for Endpoint. At the same time, the telemetry that we were streaming from Defender for Endpoint into the Red Canary engine triggered a variety of detection analytics on our end and created events for our detection engineering team to review. In reviewing the telemetry that came from Defender for Endpoint, our detection engineering team determined that the activity was indeed malicious, and they went ahead and mapped it back to an adversary emulation platform, which of course is Atomic Red Team. So up here you can see sort of like the highest level threat descriptions. As you scroll down, though, we'll start to talk about what were the detection analytics on the Red Canary side that caught this, and what are the different features or elements of a confirmed Red Canary threat detection, right? So to give you a bit of the flow, again, just to reiterate the high-level stuff here, we stream that telemetry from the Advanced Hunting API. It passes through the Red Canary engine. It gets parsed against all of our detection analytics. If it triggers a detection analytic, that creates an event. The event then gets investigated by a detection engineer. And if the detection engineer confirms the validity of that event, then they publish it as a confirmed threat detection. And that's exactly what you're looking at right now. This is a confirmed threat detection, like something you would receive if you were a customer of Red Canary. So as we scroll down, the first thing you'll notice here are the observed techniques. We also map our confirmed threats back to MITRE ATT&CK, and you can see all of that mapping here. Now, if you're playing along really, really closely, you may notice interesting that we chose to map this to obfuscated files or information and to PowerShell. The schedule task in Windows Command Shell stuff over here is a bit of a red herring, because this detection timeline actually has two tests, and the command shell and schedule task tests are what we're going to examine in the next trio of videos here. So you can ignore that for now. In this case, we mapped this to PowerShell and obfuscated files or information. And that makes sense, right? Because we used PowerShell to run that obfuscated command, and I'll show you it here in a moment. However, Microsoft mapped it to rename system utilities, which is actually how we map it in Atomic Red Team. No one is wrong here, right? The Atomic Red Team maintainers are as right as the Red Canary detection engineers and as right as the whoever does the mapping at Microsoft or whatever does the mapping at Microsoft. Point being here, attack mapping is somewhat subjective, and it kind of depends on how you're looking at the information. So And importantly, that's an interesting segue into what I'm about to say here. So the detection analytics that caught this particular activity are a detection analytic that looks for a Windows compiled PowerShell encoded command switch and a Windows PowerShell shortened encoded command switch, right? So we've got two detection analytics here. And if you think about that, we map our MITRE attack techniques at this detection analytic level. So when you look at the detection analytic, it makes complete sense why we would have mapped this to obfuscated files and information and to PowerShell. Again, we've also got this other Windows schedule test create shell detection analytic here. That's for the other test that we're not gonna talk about today. After you get through the attack technique stuff here, you can see the contributing intelligence. In this case, we detected this entirely behaviorally. However, if there was something in here that we had previously marked as an indicator of compromise, we might also highlight first party. And now the meat of the confirmed threat detection is down here in the detection timeline. So these are hand built by our detection engineering team. And they're also hand annotated. So the first thing you'll notice here is they caught on to this command.exe executing without any command line parameters, which to them is indicative of like an interactive shell session. However, they marked the threat actually occurring just after that, noting that it is highly unusual for a non-native instance of Windows PowerShell to be written to disk. You can see that here. This file creation event shows a version of PowerShell being created. And then even more unusually down here, we've got this notepad being put in the temp directory. And when we look at the binary metadata associated with that instance of notepad, very suspiciously, the file description is Windows PowerShell. The original file name is PowerShell.exe. The internal name is PowerShell. And this is signed by Microsoft, which, you know, Notepad.exe obviously would be signed by Microsoft as well. And remember from that test we ran an encoded command, but before we ran that encoded command, we took that non-native instance of PowerShell and we renamed it so it would look like Notepad. So they're also noting here that it's highly unusual for a non-native instance of Notepad to be written to disk. And then the last thing we see here is this command. So, right, we've got notepad.exe. It's using the encoded PowerShell command, which is unusual in and of itself. And then we've got this long obfuscated command, which may not be unusual, but I would say it's kind of conspicuous. So I've heard other folks around Red Canary say this before, but kind of ironically, by trying to hide certain elements of your script by encoding them, you may in fact end up drawing attention to them. And then down here, you can see the product automatically decoded the command for us. And you can see like write host, so that is a PowerShell command. And then the thing it actually writes to the host is hello from PowerShell. So if you remember in the first part of this series, we explained exactly what the test does. It writes hello from PowerShell to the command prompt. Now, as we continue to scroll down, we get into that other scheduled task test that we do not need to necessarily discuss here today. So the last thing I wanted to touch on here, and it's very important to cover, right? So you may be wondering, rightly so, I already got alerts from Defender for Endpoint. What is the purpose of getting all of these other alerts here? And the answer is redundancy, right? We, in this particular case, like we were not being duplicitous at all with our Atomic Red Team test. In fact, the entire purpose of our test was to generate alerts in Defender for Endpoint. The goals of an adversary are exactly the opposite of that, right? They don't want your tooling to create any alerting. They don't want you to see anything they've done. They're going to be duplicitous. And in addition to that, what we launched here is one atomic behavior, right? Just one little atomic piece of a technique that an adversary might use. An actual attack could consist of, you know, dozens or hundreds or even thousands of these individual behaviors. Those could happen across seconds or minutes or hours or days or weeks or even months. And like in the end, you could end up with a very, very, very high volume of different activity going on. And as a defender, you want to be able to catch all of that, right? So having this sort of redundancy gives you defense in depth, right? You've got all of the things that Defender is looking for natively. You've also got this growing library of like well-maintained detection analytics on the Red Canary side to sort of give you that more robust defense in depth against all variety of things that are going on. And then beyond that, as sort of, I wouldn't call it a fringe issue necessarily, but like sort of abstracting away just a little bit more, whether you're using, you know, Defender or any other security product or Red Canary or any other security product, having this sort of defense in depth strategy and this redundancy protects you from problems where if there's a bug in one platform or one platform's been misconfigured or there's a bug in the other one or it's been misconfigured, by compiling these two things on top of each other, right, you have the ability to have sort of insurance, right? If one thing goes wrong with one system, like hopefully it won't go wrong with the other. So that actually is all we have for this video series. So as we said, we started with that Atomic Red Team test. Then we sort of triaged those native alerts and told you what to look for in Defender for Endpoint. Then we ran through the response actions that you can take in response to alerts or incidents in Defender for Endpoint. Last but not least, we examined that advanced hunting query. And then we sort of showed you what's possible when you start streaming that raw telemetry out of Defender for Endpoint into a product like Red Canary. Now, as I was saying, as I was going through this alert, this confirmed threat detection on the Red Canary side, there was a second test that we ran. So consider this your teaser for our next trio of videos. We will be running another test and we will be going through a lot of these same features. And the reason we're gonna do that is not in this case for redundancy, but because depending on the kind of alert you're looking at or the kind of activity adversary is leveraging in your environment, you may be able to bring different features of Defender for Endpoint to bear. So we are going to continue to run these tests and continue to shoot these videos until we feel like we've covered all of the most important security or analytical features in Defender for Endpoint. For your part, if you enjoyed this video series and you'd like us to either show you particular features in Defender for Endpoint, you have specific questions you'd like us to address, or if there's specific techniques that you'd like us to test, reach out to us on Twitter or otherwise, and we will try to figure out some way of incorporating that into our video series. We'll make sure to add something that you can contact us at into the video description for this video on YouTube. So, finally, thank you for your time. We hope you enjoyed these and found them useful, and hopefully you'll tune into our next video series. So, thank you so much.